Hello and welcome to New Mexico's Naturopathic Medical Show. I'm Dr. Wendy Van Dilla, naturopathic physician, and I am your host. In the studio today with me is James Serendip. James is a hypnotherapist here in Santa Fe. And welcome, James.
Thank you, Dr. Van Dilla. It's nice to be here.
And one of the subjects that James deals with in his practice is pain management, and that's what we're going to talk about today. And James has brought some slides in from a wonderful talk that I heard at St. Vincent's Continuing Medical Education for their doctors. So let's go ahead and go right to the slideshow and talk about pain management with hypnotherapy.
Great. And so, to begin with, we're going to talk about hypnosis for pain management. And the idea here is that, next slide. Basically, what we're going to be looking at is what is pain and how do we perceive pain. A lot of people experience pain, of course. It's one of the noble truths of the Buddha. He said that everyone is going to experience pain, and we all do. But there's lots of different ways that it manifests, and there's lots of different degrees of pain. And so, therefore, there's lots of different ways that we want to try and work with it. Next slide. So the first thing is to look at the variance in pain. What are some of the different types of pain? And where in some of these differences in pain could something like hypnosis really be applicable? Because basically what we're doing with hypnosis is we're looking at the subconscious mind and we're asking ourselves, how can the subconscious influence what we're experiencing in our bodies? And a lot of people don't realize that there is a very direct connection between what we're experiencing in our bodies and what we're actually running in our minds at this subconscious level. And so if we were to look at some of the different types of pain, there's chronic versus acute pain. That's one of the big differences, to go back to that first slide. So chronic versus acute pain. When in a chronic pain situation, basically there's a signal that the body's getting all the time. And this is some place where hypnosis can be very, very effective. Because if we look at what that pain is, there's a threat to the body, right? Pain is a signal to the mind that there's something wrong and it needs attention, and so we have pain to tell us, hey, take care of this.
Right.
But in a chronic situation, usually that's kind of ongoing. The person is getting the care that they need, or else they understand what's going on, and the pain isn't really sort of necessary to explain to the mind, to explain to the individual what the threat is. So chronic pain is something that actually can respond very well to hypnotic approaches. Versus acute pain. Now, acute pain, usually there's a very specific cause. There's damage, there's a threat. This we can also work on with hypnosis, but in a little different approach. And that's going to be, rather than trying to convince the subconscious that the signal isn't necessary, it's going to be more of a training the mind to begin to ignore and pay a little less attention for the time being so that the body can relax.
So you can use hypnosis for both acute and chronic pain?
Yes, but there's different approaches.
And many patients come to doctors, I think the majority of patients come to doctors because of pain. So this is a really important tool to be exploring. It's safe, it's a non-drug approach. You can learn to do it. You can train yourself to do hypnosis, right?
Absolutely, and that's something that I really emphasize in my practice is training people to do it themselves. I think a lot of people have a natural fear of the idea of hypnosis. They see these stage shows and they think, you know, someone's going to control my mind and they're going to take control of me, and that's not really how it is at all. But often to assuage those fears and also just to empower my clients, I like to give them the tools. It's really something everyone can do. It's natural and it's relatively easy. And yeah, you mentioned that it's a non-drug approach, and that's actually one of the reasons that I really got into it. I have some friends who are medical doctors here in Santa Fe, and they were telling me about the problems of trying to deal with pain with medications, and often there's a lot of contraindications, there's a lot of problems with mixing with other drugs, and simply sometimes the medications don't work.
Mm-hmm.
So
you can develop a tolerance so that a drug can work for a while, and then the effect just wears off.
Right.
Or you have to use it more and more, and then you start getting worse effects. So tell us, James, what is hypnosis in the first place?
Okay, it's a very good question. So hypnosis is a natural state of mind, It's basically a slightly altered state. If you're familiar with the brainwave patterns that the brain goes through, sort of a normal sleep cycle, we start with a fairly high frequency of brainwave activity when we're conscious, and then as we're going to sleep, that frequency decreases, mm-hmm. and we go into progressively less and less conscious states. So hypnosis basically is a set of techniques to get people into these states of kind of a lower frequency of brainwave activity. It's a natural but altered state of mind, and it allows the subconscious to be more accessible while you can maintain your critical thinking and still be in control of yourself.
So it's a pre-sleep, you call it.
Sure.
So you're still aware, but you're very relaxed.
Right, and in fact, in a lot of hypnosis, well, even the word hypnosis derives from the name of the Greek god of sleep, hypnos. There's a lot of similarities physiologically between someone in hypnosis and someone who's sleeping, and so that's why we use a lot of language around sleep. Even they refer to certain hypnotic states as somnambulistic, which means like sleepwalking. So, yeah.
Good. And it's a natural. It's a natural
state.
Yeah,
it's an
of
absolutely
mind.
Natural state. In fact, I tell a lot of my clients that it's something that we all do all the time. Most people have experienced it, like you're driving down the highway and your mind is on your day's work, and you know, all of a sudden you realize you've gotten off at the exit and you don't even remember the last 3 miles of the highway. You know, highway hypnosis, they sometimes call that, and it really is. Just by having the repetitive action of driving, sometimes the mind will slip into what's almost like a mild trance state. So it's very natural, anyone can do it.
Yeah, a lot of people are scared that somebody's going to make them do something foolish while you're in this state. You mentioned
right.
that.
Right, and so I'm glad you bring it up, because it is a fear that a lot of people have after seeing these stage shows, you know, where people mm-hmm. are made fools of themselves. And I really would like to clarify that stage hypnosis and hypnosis for entertainment is very different from hypnotherapy and what I do. And there is a particular art to stage hypnosis, and that art really is more about being able to pick out of the volunteers who come up who are going to be the sort of latent extroverts, and the ones that, even if they don't consciously know it, have such a strong desire to please the crowd that they will go ahead and do these absurd things, even though later on they may regret it and say, oh my God, I can't believe I did that.
That's
but there's
great
a part
term.
Of them.
Yeah, I like that term, latent extrovert.
Right.
So what we're talking about is using hypnosis as a therapeutic tool to deal with pain management and many other things, but we're focusing on pain management.
That's right. And the way we can use it as a tool is because it allows us to access that subconscious mind. So, you know, it's one of the most important things to realize about the subconscious is that it does control a lot of our nervous system, the autonomic nervous system. All the portions of the nervous system that aren't under our normal conscious control are really still being run, being governed by a set of data that we have somewhere in our minds. If you think about some of the really gross responses of the body, you know, when I walk out of the room out into the daylight, the pupils of my eyes are going to constrict and get smaller. I don't tell them to do that. Now you can say that's reflex response, but as these responses get more and more subtle and complex, we start to realize that some of them are going to be based on perception and experience, and especially in how we respond to threats and fear. And most of us have heard the term fight or flight, and you know, when we perceive a threat or something dangerous, our body will start to have this fight or flight response, and it's basically preparing us to run away from a danger or, you know, attack it and fend for ourselves. But what a lot of people don't realize is that this same exact response is going on very frequently, in fact, probably most of the time for most people, but just at very low levels and fairly subtly. But there are things that we will perceive as threats, emotional threats. You know, I'm running late for work for the second time this week. My boss is going to yell at me. That's a threat. And so the body's going to perceive it as a threat, and it's going to begin to respond to that threat in the only way it knows how, which is the fight or flight response, which is probably not going to help you with an angry boss. You know, what the fight or flight response is going to do is increase your heart rate, right? Send blood flow to your large muscle groups, constricting it from the periphery, so you get cold hands, a little sweaty. But some of the effects of the fight or flight response people aren't so aware of. It will take energy away from the immune system. It'll deplete the immune system, which is not a good thing. It'll shut down the digestive system. system, which is also not a good thing. You know, you're running late for work and all of a sudden that burrito is sitting like a brick in your stomach that you had for breakfast. And it even will change how the brain functions. When you get into a fight or flight response, blood flow is moved away from the cerebral cortex and back to the limbic system. It's moved into kind of more of the reptilian areas of the brain so that you can respond in a, you know, quick, energetic, physical way instead of in a more cerebral, thoughtful way. So sometimes it sabotages us.
So what James is describing is, in medical terms, the sympathetic nervous system responses to a threat, to a fight, the fight or flight responses. And what hypnosis does, as far as I understand, is it flips the body into a parasympathetic or relaxation state.
Yeah, and that's really one of the big factors. When someone enters a hypnotic state or trance state, the body gets very profoundly relaxed and the nervous system relaxes. And we have this shift out of the sympathetic nervous system into the parasympathetic nervous system. And then all those things that I described go the opposite way. Now the immune system is going to come sort of back online, digestion will increase, and mm-hmm. you even have more access to your higher cognitive capacity. So these are all things that are beneficial in and of themselves, just from being able to kind of profoundly relax. So without any therapy part, you know, just the basic hypnosis, getting into a trance state can be very, very helpful for a wide range of medical conditions, not only pain, but certainly when you have pain going on, these things are helpful as well.
And that's an important point. Many of us doctors tell patients, oh, you're so stressed out, you need to de-stress. And this is a specific tool to learn how to flip from that fight or flight to the relaxation and healing mode.
That's right. And to realize that it's possible also, especially for people in pain. And a lot of people, once you get in pain, it starts to feel like, well, my pain is making me tense, my pain is making me anxious, and so then that tension causes more pain, and, mm-hmm. and it just kind of goes on and on that way. But to realize that it is possible to interrupt that, that's where someone like me comes in, because I can give people specific tools to say, all right, this is how you start to get control of your mind at a little bit of deeper level, so that your mind can start to influence your body in a positive way, instead of reinforcing the sympathetic response, reinforcing the pain.
And your slides had a good summary of the kind of the chronic pain.
Yeah, let's go through. Let's look at the slides and see where we are. So let's go to the next slide. And this is one I want to just touch on briefly, the gate control theory. For those who aren't familiar with it, the gate control theory is, it's been around for quite a while now, but basically it actually says that the experience of pain happens in the central nervous system. In other words, I may stub my toe and feel like my toe is really hurting, but what's actually happening in my toe is I'm getting a signal to the nervous system that's saying something's wrong there, and the pain is being experienced in my mind, in my brain. In the gate control theory, what scientists have found is that the central nervous system, the brain and the spine, can actually control those pain signals coming in. And so basically there are areas at the base of the spine, the dorsal horn of the spine, there are places that those signals can be interrupted if the central nervous system is sending a message to interrupt that pain signal. And so you see this kind of thing like on the battlefield, where a soldier gets horribly wounded and doesn't even notice it, just keeps on fighting because they have to. Their life is depending on it. And then maybe an hour later, they'll start feeling, you know, debilitating pain. In other words, the central nervous system has identified a strong need to not have that pain signal in the moment, and so it simply shuts it down. Now, what's nice about this is if that is possible, then this means all we need to do is to get to the right place in the central nervous system that can send those signals, and pain can literally be shut off right by the nervous system.
So that's a great point. Pain is felt in the brain.
Pain is felt in the brain.
We perceive it, even though the pain is... the signal is coming from somewhere else. That's what we're dealing
pain
with.
Pain is here, yeah. Pain is perceptual. It's not actually in the body. The body gets injury, but we experience pain, really, and I like to say in the mind, which I make a subtle distinction between mind and brain, and I'm not going to get into that now.
Yeah.
Let's go to the next slide and see what else we've got. So, oh, this is about pain. So this is me walking on broken glass just to demonstrate that when your mind is really relaxed,
wow.
you can...
Did you get cut at
all?
No,
there's no cuts at all, no bleeding, and this is because I was able to keep my body really relaxed so that the glass didn't actually penetrate the skin. Let's go to the next slide. Okay, hypnosis is, we've talked about this a little bit, it's natural, everyone can do it. The critical factor is relaxed. The critical factor is that part of the mind that decides what's believable or not. And so this is really important in pain management. You want to relax that, because if you're in a lot of pain and I'm now telling you, no, you feel absolutely fine, you're comfortable and relaxed, if that critical factor is in its normal state, it's going to say, I don't think so, I'm hurting here. So we need to relax that so that new ideas can be introduced to the subconscious. Okay, let's go to the next slide. And then hypnotherapy is a little different from straight hypnosis. Hypnotherapy is using that trance state to specifically alter the ideas, the beliefs being held at the subconscious level. And so it can involve a lot of different techniques and processes, and it really should only be done by someone who's been trained in it, because when you start to get into the beliefs at the subconscious level, some very funny things can come up, and we may be dealing with something like, you know, chronic pain following a surgery, and next thing you know, it's reliving childhood traumas, and it can get really emotionally intense. But it's in that emotional sort of cleansing, if you will, that very often then the pain will start to let go. So next slide. And let's see. So hypnosemantics is something that I just wanted to mention briefly. There's specific language that we use in hypnosis. And one of the things that I really emphasize to the medical community is that the voice of authority goes straight to the subconscious mind. This is so important. And for patients out there, too, to realize when a doctor is telling you something, it's probably going to be immediately accepted by the subconscious mind, and the doctors sort of have to tell you the worst case scenario. They have to prepare you. They have that, you know, informed consent, duty to warn stuff. So it's important for all of us to kind of manage our responsiveness and understand when we're being given a suggestion, even if it wasn't intentional. Suggestions really should always be in the affirmative, because the subconscious doesn't understand negations. It can't say you do not feel pain, it only sees a picture of pain. We want to avoid negative suggestions, what we call a nocebo. Just like a placebo is something that can make you feel better even though there's no real reason, you can get a nocebo too, a negative suggestion like, well, you know, only 20% of people with this condition survive. Oh my God.
So the brain says, I'm not going to survive.
Right. Instead of, yeah. You know.
I've heard that the subconscious has no sense of humor.
That's right. The subconscious has no sense of humor.
It takes things very literally.
It's very literal. That's right. And so we want to be specific. We want to use images and sensations. And then we can even use things like embedded commands, where we can sort of sneak a command into somebody. And, you know, because you're doing all the right things for your body, you're going to turn that bleeding off and everything's going to be okay. And you're going to, you know, feel fine in about 10 minutes. And so, you know, someone might not notice as to turn the bleeding off, but they're going to suddenly stop bleeding. Okay, let's go to the next slide.
I want to add in here that media literacy is a really important subject, and the advertising and the marketing companies use hypnosis, use subliminal messages to get through to us, to get us to buy things.
Well, and not just subliminal. I mean, really, if you think about
that,
television is the perfect hypnosis tool. You know, when you see the, like, swinging watches and the spinning discs and all this, there is nothing better than a television set for hypnotizing people. It is sequential imagery. It is rapid flashing images. It is eye fixation. It's really got all of the factors that you need for hypnosis. And then when you get into advertising, they throw in more and more, such as they emotionalize the commercials. When we're in high emotion, we're a lot more suggestible. They put authority figures in commercials because they know the voice of authority goes right to the subconscious. They repeat and repeat and repeat and repeat and repeat, because repetition will get through that critical factor. Finally, the critical factor says, I don't even care anymore. Fine, I believe it. I want to use Mr. Clean as a good product. So this is how they get to us. And by all means, they've studied it. They've studied
it. Oh, yes. They're masters at it.
And it's important now, relevant to this topic, to understand that when you see all the pharmaceutical ads, because there's so many pharmaceutical ads now, I would encourage folks to kind of turn off most of it and listen only to the very fast talking at the end of the ad, where they say, may induce, you know, nausea, diarrhea, blah, 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 and they tell you everything that's going to go wrong with it. Okay, and so this is what we were just talking about, how can the subconscious be accessed? Boredom, well, A lot of people are bored and they're sitting there watching the tube. Of course, sleeping and dreaming, watching TV, as we were just saying, subliminal messages. Things like exercise, that's a good way to access the subconscious. If you're a runner or something, you can start giving yourself positive affirmations, you know, that that pain that I've had in my gut is getting better every day. I'm getting healthier and fitter and stronger with every step. Any intense emotional situations, so be aware of that. If you're having an argument with somebody close to you, watch what they're saying and don't take it in. Authority figures we've talked about. Meditation and prayer, this is also accessing the subconscious and of course altered states like hypnosis. Let's go on. Next slide. Good, okay, so downward causation of trance, this is that parasympathetic response that we talked about. And basically what we're saying here is when we start to perceive safety, and remember it's all perception, then you get better digestion, better immunity, better problem solving, your reproductive system is enhanced, and of course you also experience more joy, more love, calmness, happiness. And so the whole key is perception. And so the thing that we do in hypnosis is basically we take the perception away from, oh my God, I'm in a hospital, oh my God, I'm hurt, oh my God, I have a problem, to my body knows exactly what to do with this. My body is designed to heal itself. Because I'm staying calm and accessing my resources, I'm fine. Everything's okay. I've got the right medical professionals to help me, and so I'm going to recover quickly and easily. So this is how we can use hypnosis and suggestion and imagery to start that whole chain of the downward causation into parasympathetic.
And I want to back up. I mean, what James was describing, somebody that's in a panic and in stays in that fight or flight and has certain physiological responses to what's going on in the brain. And by being aware of that and being able to switch to a more relaxed state by using positive affirmations, trusting your body, you can actually help yourself start to move into that healing mode.
Absolutely.
By what you're doing with your brain.
And then you can enhance.
Your mind.
Well, and it's both. And then you can really enhance that healing mode as well. You can speed it up. One of the areas that I love to work in is surgery prep. I do pre-surgical hypnotherapy with folks, basically suggesting that they're going to get the recovery that they want very, very quickly, and the results are astounding. I have people, you know, walking out of the hospital same day when they were told to expect to be at least 4 or 5 days recovery in the hospital, and you know, it simply can't hurt.
That's an incredible medical tool to take advantage of.
Yeah.
And you're also training yourself to do that from then on.
And that's what I love about hypnosis as an adjunct to medicine, is that it can teach people that we do have some control over our bodies and we can take responsibility for our own health and our own healing. Let's take a look at the next slide and see where we are in that. Oh, and so this is one I really wanted to show as we were talking about this a little bit. This is something called the fear, tension, pain cycle. And the idea here, again, is that when we are in fear, that triggers that fight or flight response. And one of the body's normal responses is to become tense. And when the muscles of the body tense up, guess what? We experience pain even more. And then when we feel that pain, it's going to start driving the fear, and it just cycles around and around, getting worse and worse. And so what we can do with the hypnotherapy is interfere first at the level of the fear. We turn off the fear. When we turn off the fear, then the tension subsides. When we turn off the tension, then the pain subsides. Let's go on to the next. Sympathetic nervous system. So the sympathetic nervous system is that fear reaction, and it actually increases the nerve conduction speed, and it increases the pain receptor sensitivity. So that's something we know we don't want.
So the more afraid you are, the more pain
you will
feel.
Experience. Absolutely, it's a direct effect. Yeah. And let's go to the next. Okay, and so this is, I just wanted to point out that there is some very hard research on the efficacy of hypnosis for pain management. This is from the Journal of the American Medical Association, and it talks about highly anxious patients who want to actively participate in their control of their care will respond well to hypnosis. And so it's really nice that the professional medical community is now starting to see the research, to do the research, and to understand that you can use your mind to influence something like pain.
Excellent. Good direction for them to go in.
Right. And so I just wanted to also quickly say that a couple of things about the chronic pain that we mentioned at the start. Very often, chronic pain will result from a specific injury. I get a lot of people who have been in accidents, and then there is no lasting damage to the body, but the pain persists. And so this is the kind of thing where what happens is something in the mind is trying to protect the body from that trauma and feels the need to continue that protection. And very intense pain can continue for a long, long time. That's the kind of thing that can actually completely disappear in hypnotherapy, sometimes even in a single session. And so, you know, if there are folks out there who are really suffering these kinds of pains that don't seem to have an organic cause, think about, you know, maybe there's something at the subconscious level that can be shifted, and it might actually be able to just let go and go away.
Excellent. What are some times when it's not good to use hypnotherapy?
Well, you know, I don't think it's ever harmful, but the kinds of conditions that have responded not as well are the ones where there are very intense organic causes, you know, like a bone spur or a pinched nerve or something like that. And especially if the person is aware that there is a problem, a physiological problem in the body, you know, something's out of whack in my spine. And so the subconscious doesn't want to let go of that signal because it wants you to be aware of it. It wants to keep reminding you that you have to take care of yourself. And so, you know, in these cases, I can help people to relax and maybe turn the pain down from an 8 to a 6 and get some benefit, but it doesn't always respond as well. And then, of course, the worst thing, what I won't do, is if the pain is undiagnosed. If we don't know the source of the pain, I will not do hypnotherapy on it because, you know, God forbid that there's something there that really needs attention and then we turn the pain off and they don't get it medically treated. That's a no-no.
And there are many other uses of hypnotherapy as a therapeutic tool. We're getting toward the end of our show, but I wanted to throw in a few other areas that you work with.
Uh-huh. Absolutely. A big one for me is allergies here in Santa Fe, and especially this year in Santa Fe. There have been so many allergy sufferers. Pollen, seasonal allergies respond excellently to hypnosis. I know we don't have time for me to go into why that is, but they really respond very, very well. I have a great track record with that. I work a lot with bowel conditions. Irritable bowel syndrome responds very well, and there's wonderful research out there about it, actually hypnosis being the most effective treatment for irritable bowel syndrome. And even things like Crohn's disease, colitis, more intense bowel conditions respond well as well.
Yeah, there's a direct link between your emotions and how your digestion works.
Yeah.
And we talked about that some.
And really anything that's a stress-related, if the physicians identify it as a stress-related condition, then we can say, you know, hypnosis is a good avenue to explore anyway.
And we are at the end of our show, and I want to thank James. James, thank you very much for coming in.
Oh, it was my pleasure.
And I'd like to thank Harvey and Natalie for being camera people, George for being my director, and for the viewing audience, please look at the end of the at the credits for contact information for myself, Dr. Wendy Van Dilla, and for James. We are both here in Santa Fe in private practice. I'm also up in Los Alamos. Thank you very much for viewing New Mexico's Naturopathic Medical Show.